For the making of images to aim, must thought also aim? Is one necessarily implied in the other? Is the end of image making merely a foundation upon which one can begin to discover what love and truth are? Or is that ending the very essence of truth and love? For the making of images to end, must thought also end? Is one necessarily implied in the other? Is the end of image making merely a foundation upon which we can begin to discover what love is and truth are? What love and truth are? Or is that ending the very essence of truth and love? We've talked about it the other day, how images are made. We'll go into it again because we live by images. Not only actual image created by the hand, but the image is created by the mind, by thought. These images are continuously added and taken, diminished. This is the movement that we go through. I don't know if you're watching your own images you have. You have your own image about yourself. If you're a writer, you have an image. If you're a poet, if you're a wife, husband, and all the rest of you, each one has a created for himself an image about himself. This begins from childhood, through comparison, through suggestion, by saying you must be as good as the other chap, or you must not do, or you must. So gradually this accumulative process begins. And in our relationships, personal and otherwise, there's always this image. Man, man, woman, all the rest of it. And as long as this image exists, you're either wounded, bruised, hurt, or this image prevents having actual relation to the other. We'll explain and go on into this. Now, Krishna says, can this ever end? Or is it something with which we have to live everlastingly? And in the very ending of the image, does thought end? And he asks also, are they interrelated, image and thought? And when the image-making machinery comes to an end, is that the very essence of love and truth? That more or less what he means. Have you ever actually ended an image? Voluntarily, easily, without any compulsion, without any motive, without anything, I must end my image, it must be, I won't be hurt and all the rest of it. Just voluntarily, pleasantly, easily, happily, ended the image you have. The image of God, the image of Christ, you know, all that. Various Christ. Take one image and go into it. In the explore, in going into it, you discover the whole movement of making images. You see what I'm saying? That is, if one has an image, let's say a belief, which is an image, go into it. That image, you begin to discover, in the very ending of it, there's fear, there's anxiety, there's a sense of isolation. And so you see, the image making involves all this. And if you're frightened, you carry on. See, I'd much better keep something I know rather than something I don't know. Right? Whereas if you go into it fairly seriously and deeply, who is the maker of this image? Not one particular image, but the image-making machinery, the whole of it. Is it thought? Is it the natural response, natural reaction to protect oneself? Wait a minute, don't agree yet, don't agree. Natural reaction to protect. Protect physically, right? And protect psychologically. One can understand the natural response of protecting physically. How to have food, to have shelter, to have clothes, not to be run over by buses, and so on, not to jump down a precipice. That's a natural, healthy, intelligent response. In that, there's no image. I don't know if you follow. When you see a precipice, you move over. It is not the image that's moving away. It is the physical danger you see, and the physical danger of, and the self-protective reaction makes you move. In that, there is no image. I don't know if you see. But psychologically, inwardly, we have created this image. And this image is the outcome of series of incidents, accidents, hurts, irritations, you know, which is, after all, the state of a mind which is inattentive. I don't know if you follow me. May I go on? You follow me? Does it interest you? Don't agree with me, do it yourself. Please, I don't care if you flatter me, if you agree with me, it's nothing to me. You follow? Unless you want to do it, don't do it. If you want to do it, do it. This psychological image making, is it the movement of thought? Don't you? We know. It's not, thought doesn't perhaps, very, very infinitely, thought enters in self-protective reaction, physically. But the psychological image-making must be the outcome of constant inattention, which is the very essence of hope. You understand what he said just now? Thought in itself is inattentive. Please, I carefully explained previously that attention has no center. There's no a point from which to go to another point, which is concentration. When there is complete attention, there is no movement of form. It's only the state of mind that's inattentive. And thought then being thought, which is always partial and therefore not complete attentive, creates the image. Have you followed me a little bit? That's no. I'm inattentive. I'm thinking I'm doing something else or inattentive. My wife or friend or somebody tells me you are silly. And immediately I formed an image. Or somebody say, what marvelous person you are. I formed an image. Which is the state of inattention, lacking attention, creates the image by thought, which in itself is inattentive. Got it? I've discovered something new. Right? Because thought, please look at it carefully for yourself. Thought, which is matter, thought which is outcome of memory, outcome of experience, knowledge, and that must always be limited, partial. Memory, knowledge can never be complete. Right? Can never be complete. Therefore it's partial. Therefore it is inattentive. Thought is inattentive in itself. I wonder if you see. So, when there is attention, there is no image made. You get it? It's not a conflict. You see the fact. When you insult me or flatter me, I am completely attentive. It doesn't mean a thing. But the moment I am not paying attention, my thought takes over, which is inattentive in itself, and creates you. Got it? Now, the questioner says, is the ending of image making the beginning, the essence, the love and truth? Not quite. Sorry. Not quite. Try to understand these two questions. What the love is, what truth is. We must go into very, very deeply. It may not be the time or the occasion. The speaker was going to talk about Saturday and Sunday. But doesn't matter, we'll go into it now briefly and we'll talk about it. Is love, is desire love? Very interesting. Is pleasure love? What do you say? I know all our life, most of our life, is directed towards pleasure in different forms of pleasure. And in that movement of pleasure, sex, etc., takes place, and that we call love. Right? Am I saying something not true? So we're asking, is love, desire, pleasure, and can there be love when there's conflict, when the mind is crippled with problems, problems of heaven, problems of meditation, problems of between man and woman, problems of, you follow? When the mind is living in problems, which most of minds are, can there be love? And can there is great deal of suffering, physical as well as psychological, can there be love? So I'm not answering this question, because you'll find out. And is truth a matter of conclusion, matter of opinion of philosophers, of theologians, of those who believe so deeply about dogma, rituals, which are all man-made? Is that, can such a mind know what truth is? Or truth can only be when the mind is totally free of all this jumble. See, so philosophers and others never look at their own lives and go off into some metaphysical, psychological world, which they begin to publish and become famous. So truth is something, sir, that demands extraordinary clarity of mind, that has no problem whatsoever, physical or psychological. A mind that has not known even conflict. You understand what I'm saying? The memory of conflict must end. You follow me? Because we have great many present and unpleasant memories, remembrances that are delightful remembrances of most people. With that mind, with that burden, we are trying to find truth. It's something. You understand? It's impossible. So, a mind that is astonishingly free from all man-made psychology, from all that, then truth can only come into, truth is something that can, that is, when there is love and compassion. Cannot have love and compassion when there is any other violence. When you are clinging to some attachment, when attachment becomes all important, so. Sirs, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not being personal. This is not world's truth. If it was not something actual, I wouldn't speak. You understand? I wouldn't be dishonest to myself. If it is not a fact, I would be such a terrible hypocrite. I wouldn't ever sit up anywhere on a platform or talk to anybody. You understand what I'm saying? This requires tremendous integrity.